soul. This bag of bones, I tried with all my might, but I just can't win the fight. I'm slowly drifting, a vagabond. And just when I ran out of the road, I met a man I didn't know, and he told me that I am not alone. Lord, it picked me up, he turned me around, he placed my feet on solid ground. I thank the Master, I thank the Savior, because he healed my heart, changed my name.
Another one, I am free. I am free. I am free. Pick me up. Master, I thank the Savior. So heal my heart, change my name, forever free. I'm not the same. I thank the Master, I thank the Savior. I thank God.
I thank God, I thank God. I'm going to give you 1 second to just thank God. You say, God, thank you. Thank you, God.
Turn it for good. victory, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory.
Rehearsal for today, you know, we talked about worship, and I wanted to share it with you because I feel it was kind of what God was leading me to talk about anyway, so I think it was just, you know, divinely placed on our hearts. You know, worship is more than just singing, it's more than just coming together, but when we think about it, like, what is it? What is the crux of the worship? And, you know, we spoke about obedience, we spoke about listening to God, we spoke about doing His will versus our will. And I think what we kind of landed on is that worship is our release of control. It's our willing release of control. You know, we learn as we grow closer to God that it's no longer about us. And that's not to belittle our purpose in life. It's not to belittle our existence. It's meant to be a relief of burden. You know, because controlling things is so hard and it's so heavy. And we want to control so much, and we don't realize that the minute we turn that control and give it to Him, things become easier, they become lighter, they become just, yeah, less heavy. And so, you know, this is something that, especially, you know, our worship and our tech team, as we try to lead worship, it's something that we struggle with, because, you know, we want to control all the aspects, we want to control how things look and sound, and want to make sure it's the best it can be for the glory of God. But, you know, we're learning that it'll be for the glory of God when we release the control we would try to have over it. And so I just want to encourage all of us, as we go into the next song, intentionally talks about losing our own will and turning God's will, to just, you know, really think about those words, about what they mean, because it's a song that's a little older, so some of us may have heard it before. And, you know, when lyrics get familiar, when prayers get familiar, we can sometimes forget the meaning behind them. And so I just want to challenge all of us to really listen to the words of the song as we sing them, and, you know, just give up our control over how we show up in this space and just praise God.
Thank you. Honored to be in your presence. God, as Jenny shared, allow us just to lay everything at your feet, to let go of the control of the things we're holding onto in our life. God, when we do, we feel this release because we know you are sovereign and good, and you want the best for us. So as we go throughout our day and through our week, God, just allow us to just release control. Fully worship you and to be in your presence. God, I pray for Grayson as he comes and he shares your word. God, I pray that you would allow us to open our ears and our hearts to what you have for us today. Thank you for everything you do. Thank you for loving us and that we get to come and just worship and be in your presence. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hi, you can have a seat. My name's Dawn. And I'm just so happy to be here today. This is family, you know, and I so look forward every Sunday to coming and seeing you guys and being a part of this family. We believe that church is a family, and we're hoping that you join us. So when you came in, you should have gotten a Connect card. And on that Connect card, if you fill it out, there's a place for you to check that you are trying five. So we know that you can't get to know a church in just one Sunday. So we ask that you come for five Sundays and see if we're the church for you. If not, we'll help you find one. It's going to be hard to find one better, but we know some churches, and so we'll help you find one that's going to be a good fit for you, because we believe that everybody should be in a family of God. And so I know that being here will be a blessing to you. We're glad that you're with us. Also, if this is your very first Sunday, check that on your card and make sure you can give it back to me or to somebody else in a blue shirt. We're going to make sure that you get a Chick-fil-A gift card in exchange for that card because it's your first Sunday. So also, there's something really special coming up on September 10th. So we want you to mark that on your calendar. There's going to be a really special Sunday coming called Bring One Sunday, and you'll get more information about it, but just save the date. The rest of the information is on the rundown.
Good morning and welcome to Point Church Garner. We're so excited that you're here. Have you been through Rooted at Point Church? Then listen up. We're excited to launch a brand new small group called Deep Dive. This is an 8-week study designed as a next step for people who have completed Rooted that seeks to make core biblical truths accessible for everyone. If you want to deepen your faith in a meaningful way, then we encourage you to sign up for Deep Dive starting August 24th. The cost is only $20. If that's a problem, don't worry. Scholarships are available. Let us know if you're interested by making a note on your Connect card or by visiting a volunteer in a blue shirt after the service. Taste of the Triangle is coming up this fall, and it's time to grab your tickets. This is your last chance to get early bird tickets for just $85 before they jump up to $99 this Tuesday, August 15th. Grab your tickets now by heading to carolinacarecenter.org/taste. Now, do you need some time to unwind after a long day of work or taking care of the kids? Then you won't want to miss out on the next trivia night we're hosting August 29th. We'll be back at Rudina's Pizza in Garner. Categories will range from food and sports to books and TV, so join us to test your knowledge at 6:30. Do your finances bring you fear or freedom? Whether you're digging out of debt or planning your future, join us for our upcoming series, Making Change, beginning next Sunday, August 20th, because now's the time to build a foundation that endures. We can't wait to learn how to invest in a brighter tomorrow by making change. As we continue in our worship service, we want to invite you to worship through giving. Giving to Point Church is making an investment in what God is doing in this world. When we as the church live generous lives, we get to see the impact that God can have on a community. If you'd like to give to what God is doing in our midst, you can go to pointchurch.com/give and select the Garner campus. Or if you prefer to use your phone, you can text give and a dollar amount to 77977. It's quick, easy, and you can feel good about making an eternal impact. To stay up to date with everything you just heard, head over to our news page by visiting pointchurch.com/garnernews, and we hope you enjoy the rest of today's service.
Good morning, Point Church. Hey, oh, that was good. That was like the best yet. I feel good. It's a good Sunday. My name is Grayson. I'm the pastor here. And again, I just want to, as Dawn said, just welcome you, especially if this is your first time. We know that trying out a new church for the first time can be intimidating. And so we just want to extend a very special warm welcome. Or maybe this is the first time you've been in a while. We're actually finishing up our series called Summer of Psalms, where we've been looking at these ancient psalms, these ancient songs. Psalms is kind of the songbook of Israel. And so we're looking at these songs from the past to see how they can impact our present and our future. But let me start by asking a really quick question, just show of hands. How many of you have been to the Grand Canyon before? I saw some of those hands shoot up pretty quickly. All right, that's maybe just under half, I guess. That's pastor math. But that's maybe half. I went to the Grand Canyon when I was about 18, 19 years old. And something that I hear a lot about the Grand Canyon, I experienced a little bit of myself, is people say when you first go to the Grand Canyon, you get out of your car or whatever, and you walk up, and suddenly before you stands this big vista. Actually, I think we have a video of some footage of the Grand Canyon. But you walk up and you see this incredible vista, and it's just beautiful. And then you snap a few pictures, and you're like, I just can't believe this is here. I can't believe God made this. How amazing is this? And then after about 5 minutes, you go, what's next? I'm kind of hungry, right? And you turn and you walk back to your car. And it's sort of funny when you think about it, because the Grand Canyon is so amazing. Just actually some fast facts I want to share with you. The Grand Canyon National Park is, believe it or not, bigger than the entire state of Rhode Island. You might not think that's very impressive because, you know, Rhode Island's kind of small. But, I mean, you know, that's a big park. The drive from the North Rim Visitor Center to the South Rim Visitor Center is about 200 miles and takes roughly 4 hours. That's huge, y'all. That's big. From the rim of the Grand Canyon to its lowest point, maybe you've heard this before, there is a 25-degree temperature difference. That's big, right? From the top to the bottom. And then lastly, no one is entirely sure how old the Grand Canyon is, but a number of fossils have been discovered by archaeologists. And so, needless to say, the Grand Canyon is a big deal. And it is really neat. But it's funny because not only with the Grand Canyon, but even other things in our life, we find ourselves sometimes coming face to face with them, and we're amazed one moment, and then the next, we're sort of over it, right? We're sort of, you know, bored. We say, what's next? Actually, if you want to do something funny, if you want some entertainment for a few minutes, look up one-star reviews on Google of the Grand Canyon, and you won't be disappointed. But I'll just leave that with you. But that happens, right? It's sort of human nature where the abnormal, the special, sooner or later becomes sort of mundane. And again, that happens whether it's a new car, whether it's a, you know, an exciting new house you get, or whatever it is. Suddenly, at some point along the way, we can't exactly pinpoint it, but things just kind of become, bleh, normal. And the same, I think, is true in our walk with God. When we look at the amazing majesty that is God, and we think about the maker of heaven and earth, as God says to Job, the one who put the stars in their place, when we read about Genesis and we come to a place where we're just like, oh, it's incomprehensible. Not only that, but that the God of the universe would make himself a child to be raised and sacrifice. Like, there are sometimes times in our life where that hits us in a fresh way. And maybe it was that first time for you when you really committed your life to Christ. It just hits you and you just think, how can this be? This is amazing. But then somewhere along the way, even in our walks, God becomes mundane. And if we're being really honest, like that happens with all of us. That happens with me. Like, sometimes in my life, it's like, well, what's so special? God, can you impress me again? And if you feel like that, I want to let you know, not only are you in good company here, but you're also in good company in the Bible. That happens many times with people who are following God, is we as people are forgetful, and we forget what the Lord does. And so in this psalm, as we finish up our series, I think this psalm does a really good job of teaching us something important about our relationship with the Lord, and that is the importance that reverence has in our walk with him. In fact, the big idea I have for you this morning is simply, if you're taking notes, is that reverence is our response to a God who works wonders. Reverence is our response to a God that works wonders. And if you're thinking to yourself, what does that even mean? Like, and what does reverence even mean? Well, just hold on a second. We'll get into that. First, though, if you have your Bibles, go ahead and turn to Psalm 111. 111, birthday candles. Turn to Psalm 111. If you don't have your Bibles up there, up with you, the words are going to be up here on the screen. But if you don't have a copy of God's Word, we'd love to give you one for free just so you can take God's Word with you wherever you go. So see myself, see someone in a blue shirt. We'd love to put one in your hands. But this is Psalm 111, and this is what the psalmist writes. It says, "Praise the Lord." Some of your translations may say, "Hallelujah." "Praise the Lord. I will thank the Lord with all my heart as I meet with his godly people. How amazing are the deeds of the Lord! All who delight in him should ponder them. Everything he does reveals his glory and majesty, and his righteousness never fails. He causes us to remember his wonderful works. How gracious and merciful is our Lord. He gives food to those who fear him. He always remembers his covenant. He has shown his great power to his people by giving them the lands of other nations. All he does is just and good, and all his commandments are trustworthy. They are forever true, to be obeyed faithfully with integrity. He has paid a full ransom for his people. He has guaranteed his covenant with them forever. What a holy, awe-inspiring name he has. Fear of the Lord is the foundation of true wisdom. All who obey his commandments will grow in wisdom. Praise his name forever." Amen. As I like to do, just a little bit of context in this psalm. So we don't know, as with a lot of psalms, we don't know exactly who wrote this, but we do see some interesting things about this psalm. For starters, it actually mixes a few different genres together. So it mixes a few things together. We see bits and pieces of Israel's historical, legal, and wisdom traditions mixed together. which is pretty neat. And you might be wondering, why is that? Part of it may have to do with something we can't fully appreciate when we read the Bible in English. And that is, in Hebrew, this psalm was written as an acrostic, meaning that each line starts with a particular letter of the Hebrew alphabet. And so as you read that in Hebrew, every verse is starting with a different letter, like you might think A, B, C, D in our own alphabet. But regardless, this was a way that they could get across a purpose, which I think is pretty clear. And again, that this psalm praises the works of God, that it is teaching us to worship, to revere Him, particularly through His works. And we'll talk about that in a moment. So again, if you're taking notes, that takeaway, that big idea, that header, is that reverence is our response to a God who works wonders. Now, it's actually not that unusual when we think about looking at the works of God, particularly in creation, that we see the glory of God displayed. In fact, during the scientific revolution, many of the scientists who got that underway were followers of Jesus, who believed that as they explored nature, as they tested theories, as they explored the inner workings of creation and looked at the stars and everything else, that they were learning something about the Creator Himself, that they were seeing God's glory manifested in His creation. If you go for one example, if you go to Cambridge University and on the entrance of their famous laboratory, you will see Psalm 111, verse 2 there. You'll see that plastered above the entrance, which is pretty neat. And then just to give you one other example, there's a famous French chemist named Louis Pasteur who once said this. He said, "The more I study nature, the more I stand amazed at the work of the Creator. Science brings men nearer to God." And so there's so much in creation that we can see that draws us to Him, but also the works in our own life. Not just what God has done out there, but also what God has done in here in our own life. That is cause for reverence. And so as we sort of break this psalm down, I want to point out three aspects, three things that I think this psalm teaches us about reverence that can make a difference in your life and in mine. So to break that down, let's look at verse 1 again. Again, the psalmist says, "Praise the Lord, hallelujah. I will thank the Lord with all my heart as I meet with His godly people." Some of your translations may say congregation, right? The people of the God. And all hallelujah is, if you're curious, is that's really just a shout of praise. There's not even really a great translation for hallelujah other than to say praise the Lord. It's just a shout of emphatic praise. And I think this verse reveals to us the first thing about reverence, which is that reverence is first and foremost expressed through worship. Reverence is first and foremost expressed through worship. The Bible, again, is filled with examples of people responding to the works of God with praise and with worship, and actually just how God coincidentally works things together. That's even what our praise team was talking about this morning. What Jenny was talking about is, as worship, one part of worship is releasing that control. And sometimes I think we overcomplicate what worship is, or we misunderstand what worship is. You know, coming from the Old English word, worship actually means worth-ship. It means giving something ultimate worth. It means giving something ultimate value in your life. And notice that worship is something we ascribe, right? We give. That's why we're called to worship the Lord, but that's why the Bible also warns us against worshiping idols. Now, we think in the Bible, idols, okay, well, they're just, you know, carved images of stone and wood. Like, okay, well, we don't do that anymore. But if worship is giving the spot of ultimate worth to something in our life, well, then that could be anything. It could be a statue, or it could be money. It could be sex, it could be power, it could be control, it could be anything. It could be ambition. I like this definition that I've used before from John Piper. I just think it's a helpful definition of worship, where he says that worship, true worship, biblical worship, God-honoring worship, is treasuring Christ in our hearts. Worship is treasuring Christ in our hearts. I love that definition because I think we all know what it's like to treasure something. Like some of you might treasure a hand-me-down from a grandparent, maybe a deceased grandparent, and they gave you something. They gave you an antique or something. And you also, it's one of those things where you feel like too guilty to throw it away, so you got to find somewhere for it in your house. But see, there's that sort of like awkward dichotomy. Like, I don't really want this, but I also treasure it. But we know what that's like. We know what that's like. You know what it's like perhaps to treasure a baby blanket from your kid that's all grown up. And you hold on to that. Or maybe it's a photo album, or it's your wedding ring. Or we know what it's like to treasure things. And so I think that's a helpful definition, because when we think about Christ in our hearts, whatever we do, if we truly want to worship him, it starts by first treasuring him in our hearts. And that's helpful because it reorients our mind of what true worship is. What it helps us to see is what true worship isn't. Right? True worship isn't necessarily singing a song. It's not humming along to your favorite tune on K-Love as you drive around, right? Like, that's not what worship is. If for some reason you didn't make it in here when our worship music started, it's not like, well, I missed out on worship, right? No, worship goes so far beyond that. It's us treasuring and clinging to him and confessing that we would do anything for him. And that goes beyond the songs that we sing. I think we see that clearly in what Paul says in Philippians chapter 3, where the Apostle Paul writes, "What is more, I consider everything a loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things. Now I consider them garbage that I may gain Christ." He is saying, more than anything else, I value Christ above all else. That's why he goes on to say, I know how to live with a lot, and I know how to live with a little, because I know what is of ultimate worth, this thing that can never be taken away from me. And if I cling to that, I am truly rich, no matter whether my bank account has 30 zeros in front of it or two. You might relate to one of those numbers more than the other, but you know, no matter what my situation is, I can truly worship, I can truly treasure him, because he is my ultimate worth. And again, that also means that your life, no matter what you're doing, your life can be one of worship. Not just when you're singing songs, and I'm not just knocking that, by the way. I mean, that is great. That is a really helpful way of reminding ourselves of the goodness of God. But it means that no matter what your occupation is, no matter what you're doing, your job can be an act of worship. You don't just worship God when you join staff at a church. No matter whether you're a plumber or a firefighter or a mom or a dad or a grandparent, they can all be acts of worship. When we expand our understanding of worship, it gives us a much more robust understanding of what it means to glorify God. So when you love your spouse well, it is an act of worship. When you are an honest employee, it is an act of worship. I think that also gets at what Paul says in 1 Corinthians, where he says, so no matter whether you eat, drink, or whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God. It doesn't matter what you're doing. If you scrub toilets, scrub it to the glory of God. You bring your neighbor some sugar because they're out, do it to the glory of God. No matter what you do, do it to the glory of God. And just one other really small note before we move on. We could just talk forever about verse 1. But I think what's important to also highlight is in verse 1, he says, I will praise the Lord, right? So hallelujah, it's a personal shout of praise, but he also says that he praises the Lord with his godly people, with the congregation. And so we see that worship is not just personal, it's not just private, but it's also corporate. Like, that's why it's so important that we come together. That's so important, by the way, that we show up on time. And I'm not just saying that because it's like, hey, be on time, wagging my finger. No, I'm saying there's something special that happens when we come into worship together. When we participate in singing of the praises of the Lord, there's something powerful, there's something meaningful there. And there's something that happens in us when we don't just sing privately, when we don't just worship privately, but we come together to worship, both through singing, both through generosity, both through service. Enough about that. We'll move on. So verses 2 through 9, let's look at those. Verses 2 through 9 sort of focus in, hone in on what that worship is. And particularly what the psalmist does is the psalmist looks at the works of the Lord, looks at his power, his provision, his goodness, his justice, among other things. And verse 2 sort of summarizes it, where he writes, "How amazing are the deeds of the Lord! All who delight in him should ponder." This is the second thing we see about reverence, is that reverence is fueled by God's actions. Reverence is fueled by God's actions. It's fueled by his work. The psalmist is calling on Israel to remember the deeds of the Lord. And if you look at a lot of the Old Testament, that's what it is. If you look at the festivals of the Old Testament, Passover, all these other things, they're designed so that people would remember the works of the Lord. So that, yes, they see the works of the Lord in creation and creating everything we see around us and our experiences, but it's also an act to remember what God has done in your own life personally. And I think that is why he says in verse 2 to think on them, to ponder them. One of the things I started doing as an adult is I started keeping a collection box. I probably got it from my mom. She keeps all sorts of stuff. But I got a shoe box. And what I do is I just put some little memorabilia in there. I put little things that were meaningful to me. So they might be some letters that I wrote between Rachel and I when we were dating or when we were engaged. Some of those letters I kept. Most of them are super embarrassing, so they got tossed, but the good ones I kept. There are some really nice cards that people wrote for me, especially early in my ministry, that just meant the world to me, and I hung on to those. Some of them I kept, kids' pacifiers, you know, stuff like that. And over the years, the reason why I do that is because over the years, I want to be able to collect some of these memories so that when I'm older and when I'm retired and my memory's not as good, that I can look back at those things and help those memories to come flooding back. That I can look back at those things and I can remember the wonderful life that the Lord has given me. And then I also, much less consistently, I have a little journal. It's just a Google Doc I open up, and like twice a year, I write some things in it, and I wish I was more consistent. I'm just not, but I do that. Even just one or two entries in there, there's something I can look back years now and ask myself, what was I thinking? What was God doing in my life when I was 25 or 30 or 35 or 40 or whatever it happens to be? And I can just look through that, and more importantly, I can see the goodness of God in my life. When the rest of my life, maybe in the moment, because we're so pessimistic sometimes, might feel so dark or so difficult, I can look back and say, oh, gosh, God has been so good to me. Like, if you don't have any way of remembering those things that the Lord has done in your life, I encourage you some way, whatever you do, I mean, tattoo it on yourself. I don't care. Like, do something to remember what the Lord has done in your life. Because, again, sometimes in the darkest seasons of our life, when God feels most absent, most distant, we've looked at some of those psalms that talk about God feeling so far away, we can look back at his past care for us, knowing that his faithfulness in our past reveals his faithfulness in our future. And if God was faithful then, he'll be faithful now. And sometimes in the lens of depression or in the lens of struggle, in the lens of suffering, it feels like God is nowhere to be found. But if we are quick to remember the works of the Lord, we can say, no, he was there then. And I know, even if I can't see it, he is here now. And then, of course, if we ever doubt whether or not God cares for us, ultimately we can look at Jesus. I mean, look at verse 9 again. The psalmist says, he has paid a full ransom for his people. He has guaranteed his covenant with them forever. What a holy, awe-inspiring name he has. It's one of the profound truths of Scripture that the maker of heaven and earth willingly laid down his life for you and me, that the God of wonders performed the wonder of allowing himself to be sacrificed for your shortcomings and mine, for his creatures. And more than anything, if nothing else, that can fill our hearts with reverence. I once read a story, maybe it's true, maybe it's just a preacher story, but I once read a story about this woman in Soviet-occupied Russia, and she was in a church, and she was an older woman, and she was in a church and she was praying, and after a very heartfelt prayer, there was a statue of Jesus, and she just kissed the feet of Jesus and stood up. And when she did that, really quickly, a Russian soldier walked up to her and said, hey, would you kiss the feet of Joseph Stalin like you'd kiss the feet of Christ? And with a lot of quick wit and without missing a beat, the woman said, yes, if he was crucified for me. God works in creation to demonstrate his power and his creativity, but his work on the cross demonstrates his unending love for you and me. And so if we ever feel like we're not worth anything, if we ever feel like God has abandoned us, what can we do? Look back at the cross and let that fill our hearts with worship. Let that fill our hearts with reverence. And finally, in verse 10, Verse 10 shows us one more aspect of reverence. It says in verse 10, fear of the Lord is the foundation of true wisdom. All who obey his commandments will grow in wisdom. Praise him forever. If fear is one of those strange words that when we read in the Bible, we think like, that's really weird. Like, that's a really odd thing. Like, fear of the Lord. And maybe you've heard before that fear of the Lord, a fear of the Lord, is not just like being scared of the Lord. Like, I hope he doesn't jump out, right? Like that's not the type of fear of the Lord that's being talked about. But fear of the Lord is actually this sort of healthy respect, this honor, or this reverence that we give him. Just sort of by way of example, I used to ride horses in middle school and high school. And one of the things you're taught when you first start riding horses is, yes, they're beautiful, majestic, amazing animals. But we tend as a society to romanticize them to the point where we forget that they are powerful beasts. They can pull three times their own body weight, and a kick from a horse has the potential to kill an adult human. So they're powerful beasts that we've somehow domesticated. And so what they teach you is when you're riding, they or when you're, you know, cleaning the horse, they'll say, okay, now be careful when you walk around behind the horse because you don't want to spook it, right? If you spook it and it doesn't know that you're there, it thinks you're something else, it's going to kick or it's going to rear or something's going to happen. And so they say, first, you know, let the horse know you're there. And then just to be safe, you take this big, wide walk around the back of the horse to get to the other side, or you walk around the front so it can see you the whole time. And about 3 months ago or so, I took, maybe more than that, I took my daughter riding for the first time. And so we took her out. I don't have a horse, but we had some friends who did or do. And so we took my oldest daughter out to ride horses. And you know, she was so excited, and she was brushing the horse and all that stuff. But I explained to her, sweetie, you got to be really careful not to walk around the back of the horse because it might accidentally kick you. And that was it, and she understood it. But what was funny is a few weeks later, I think we saw a horse in a pasture or something like that. And she looked at me and she said, Daddy, are horses mean? And I said, not usually. I mean, not if they're well trained. I mean, some are. And she said, but you said that the horse would kick me. And I stopped and I explained to her. I said, well, sweetie, you know, horses are generally nice, especially if they're trained. I said, but they're also really powerful. And if it doesn't know you're there, if it's scared of you, if it thinks you're something else, then it might accidentally kick you. And so we have to respect the horse and understand that, yes, it's an amazing animal. It's a beautiful animal. It's an amazing creature. It's also a powerful creature. And I hope that's a helpful way of thinking about our walk with the Lord, where we say, yes, God is a God of love and forgiveness and mercy and grace. He's a God of power. He is a God of righteousness. He is a God of justice. He is a God that is worthy of our undying obedience. And obedience, especially in our Western culture, that's an uncomfortable word to hear. But gosh, I mean, if nothing else, God is worthy of that. Now, fortunately, right, we don't serve a God who just uses his authority to abuse us. He instead uses his power and his might to love and care and shepherd us, right? He is the good shepherd. But he is worthy of being respected. He is worthy of reverence. And that's the sort of respect we should have. And so my final point is really, it's nothing creative. If I can't, you know, if I feel like my human words are failing me, a good rule of thumb is just to go back to Scripture. And what does it say? That I would say the reverence is the foundation of wisdom. Reverence is the foundation of wisdom. And I think reverence, again, gets at that word for fear, what the original word really means. That reverence is the foundation of wisdom. And wisdom is the ability to live life well. It's the skill to live life well. I think we all know that wisdom is different than knowledge. Like, we have some people who are really smart, but they're not very wise. Like, they know a lot of stuff, but we wouldn't trust them with much, right? And then we know some people, maybe perhaps, that are very uneducated, but you would look at them and you'd say they're wise beyond their years. Or wisdom is that ability to take knowledge and apply it. It's the ability to live life skillfully and well. And so maybe you can quickly recall people who you would say, yeah, they're wise. My grandfather, my grandmother, my mom or dad, my friend, whoever it was, you know, they've got wisdom. Now, that's not to say what we see here is that wisdom, the foundation of wisdom is reverence. It's a fear of the Lord. But that's not to say that non-Christians can't be wise. So maybe you're in here and you don't know the Lord, and you say, well, me. I feel like I'm no dummy. Well, the thing is, we all know that we exist in this world together. We partake of the Lord's creation together. As St. Augustine says, all truth is God's truth. And so we are all able to grapple at that truth and to attain some amount of wisdom. But I do believe that no one who doesn't revere the Lord will ever be able to find the answers to life's deepest questions apart from God, and never be able to apply those truths. Philosophers will tell you that unless you assume some sort of divine being, it is really difficult to get at absolute truth. It is really difficult, if not impossible, to get to moral values. And that's part of why our culture and many academics or people in academia struggle with that, is because they say, well, if we leave some sort of God, well, then where does that leave us? And there's a diversity of opinions on that. But Scripture brings us back and says the fear of the Lord, a reverence for the Lord, is the foundation. It is the beginning of wisdom. And one of the reasons I would say that I am a follower of Jesus, because I believe that the Bible makes the most sense out of life, explains reality the best. And if I am convinced of that, then what else should my response be but reverence and worship and obedience and submission? So just a really quick recap. So you see, reverence is our response to a God who works wonders, and we've seen that reverence played out in three different ways. That reverence is expressed in worship, it's fueled by God's action, and it's the foundation of wisdom. But I do just want to offer one more thought, maybe a word of caution. And I'll close with this simple story, and then we'll be done. But, in the last few decades, commercial space travel has become a thing. It's technically been a thing since, I think, the 80s, but it's sort of become a little bit more popular in the last few years. Well, popular if you have like $300,000 to burn. But you've seen that more and more people are doing that. And I think it was October 13th in 2021, 90-year-old William Shatner, Captain Kirk himself, took a ship, plane, I'm not sure what you would call it, but took a vehicle to the edge of space with Blue Origin, which is Jeff Bezos's company. And what was meant to be this sort of exciting, like, momentous moment in his life turned out to be something a little bit different for him. In fact, this is what he said in an interview shortly after he stepped out of the plane. He said, "My trip to space was supposed to be a celebration. Instead, it felt like a funeral. It was among the strongest feelings of grief I have ever encountered. The contrast between the vicious coldness of space and the warm nurturing of Earth below filled me with overwhelming sadness." Now psychologists have noted this effect. It's called the overview effect, and it tends to happen to people when they see something amazing. The Grand Canyon, the Earth from space, like something that's almost otherworldly. Like, it's so incredible, it's hard to process that. It gives you this sort of transcendent feeling. And they said often what's accompanied with that feeling of transcendence, that feeling of hugeness, is a feeling of sadness and grief and insecurity. And that's what Shatner experienced. And what should have been an amazing experience became something much more sober. And my point in sharing that is that I believe when we behold the God of Scripture, and we don't see him as something altogether lovely, altogether beautiful, altogether worthy of respect, we will instead see him as something to be dreaded. And that's not a threat, right? That's not because God will beat you. Because when we look into the face of God and we see the Lord and we don't view him from a place of love and respect and reverence, we see him as something entirely different. In fact, I would say, I think maybe many of you have come from a place of really religion rather than a place of relationship with the Lord, where you feel like God is that oppressive figure in your life. Like, you come to church or you read your Bible or you pray because you're paying your divine taxes, like, just to get the man off my back. Like, your relationship with him isn't one of loving intimacy, but is instead one of sort of like trying to feed the beast to keep him away. And we see in Scripture, when people have encountered the Lord, and not out of a place of reverence, it is much greater. It is a place of true fear. It is a place of true dread, because when they stand before a holy and good God and they don't see him as he's given himself in love They see him as something to be feared, as something to be backed away from. And so my encouragement to you is to try to look at God with fresh eyes. And maybe that happens this morning, but try to open yourself up to him in a way that maybe you haven't before. Maybe you came here because someone invited you. Maybe you came out of habit. And again, you just feel like, well, I'm doing this to pay my God tax. You know, I'm going to put a few bucks in the Connect card bucket to pay my God tax. But I want to encourage you just to open your eyes up to him and see him in a new way. Maybe later this afternoon, take a walk in the shade. It's a little toasty. But take a walk. Discover his beauty in creation. Meditate on his faithfulness in your life. Start a journal. Start a collection box. And just think about what the Lord has done in your life. Really consider how life can start making sense with him. And I believe if we do that, man, the ripple effects won't just be that our relationship with God changes, but I also think it'll make us better husbands and parents and brothers and sisters and neighbors and employees. Like when we understand that, you know, there is a holy God that has a right over my life, but yet who loves me enough to give himself for me, and that'll change everything. That'll change everything. And so if you haven't done that, in a moment, we're actually going to have a baptism, which is always amazing, a representation of how our old life has been buried and our new life is raised with Christ. But that invitation is open to you too. If you're sitting there and you think, wow, like my view of God has been so warped, maybe from bad experiences, maybe church hurt, maybe a family member who just represented Christ in a really terrible way. I need to see him with fresh eyes. But don't let this moment go by. If you've never given yourself to him, you can do that now. And the first step of doing that is baptism. After you give yourself, you say, Lord, you want me and all my brokenness and all my mess. You died for me. That response is when we give our life to him that we say, I'm going to demonstrate that in baptism. And so if that's you, come and see me, come and see someone, and we'd love to talk with you about that. Will you pray with me? Father, we recognize in this moment that you are God, that you are Lord, that you have a right and a claim over our life, and thank you that you do. Because, Lord, we know when we take our life into our own hands, it gets ugly real quick. But we thank you, Lord, that you are a God of patience, that you are a God of mercy, that you are a God of justice and righteousness and goodness and faithfulness. And above all, we thank you for Jesus, how you demonstrated that all those years ago on the cross, dying in our place when we didn't deserve it at all. Father, I pray that this morning, that if someone hasn't made that connection, that commitment, haven't given themselves to you, Lord, that you would do what's necessary to bring them to that place. But Lord, also, if there's just some of us who need our eyes washed, need to see you clearly, maybe we've fallen in a rut, maybe we've forgot something, whatever it is, Lord, I pray that you would bring that person to a place where they see you in your goodness and in your glory, and you filled our heart. God, that you help them to truly treasure you. And as they do that, Lord, may you show yourself to be faithful in other areas of their life. May you show up in other places, even where they least expect it. Lord, we love you, and we thank you for this time. I pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. On your way in, you should have received a little communion packet. I invite you to go ahead and take that out. Communion is something we do each week, and if you're not a follower of Jesus, like, we're glad you're here. Just ask you to refrain from taking it and just think about, meditate, ponder the words that you've heard this morning. But if you are a follower of Jesus, I invite you to take that out. And we do it every week because, goodness, we need to be reminded. I need to be reminded. I am so forgetful. And so when we take this, we remember the death of Christ in many ways. And in fact, he as he sat with his disciples, held up a piece of bread, and he said, this is my body, which is broken for you. As often as you eat, you do so in remembrance of me. So church, I want to invite us to take and remember what Christ did for you and me. Let's take and eat together. And as you open up the cup represents his blood. It was spilled and poured out for you, willingly. No less painfully, but willingly. We take and remember his sacrifice. I want to invite you to stand. There's a number of ways that we can respond in worship. Singing is one of them, and that is an important one. But you can respond through prayer. If you need prayer, we'd be back there. We'd love to pray for you. Respond through giving. Of course, respond by taking communion. But I just ask that as you stand and worship with us, don't leave this moment without responding in the way that God leads you. You stand and worship with us.
Thank you. For coming to worship with us today. We're so glad you're here. Don't forget to fill out your Connect card and drop it in the bucket on the way out, as well as any offering that you have. Also, if you're a first-time guest, we'd love to meet you. And so you can go to the big blue square in the lobby, and you'll also receive a $5 gift card. And anything else, you can come talk to us. Also, we have a baptism happening today right after service. And so if you want to go and head to the lobby, we get to celebrate that together. Have a good week.